interface.
That's where we were. Right. One of the first things that is important is help in Touch Designer. And help has multiple things, and we just put something in, which is the parameter help, which was something that was missing, but a lot of people were asking for. So if you have a node selected here, you can select various nodes by clicking on them. Then you see in the right-hand corner, you see the parameters for that node. If you don't see those parameters, then you probably hit the P key. The P key toggles parameters. And once you have these parameters up, you can hit the Alt key and then Touch hangs for a second because it loads a component in, which holds all the help data. And then when rolling over these parameters, you get a description of the parameter. So it would be the Alt key. Do Macs have Alt keys? Command.
They have Option Alt.
Or yeah, might be the Command or I'm not sure actually, sorry, which one it is on Mac. But basically this gives you the help for each parameter. Very useful if you don't know, or if you want to know what each of these is doing. Another way to get help, and where this help also comes from, is our wiki. So in the top bar here, you have a direct link to our wiki. And that opens up. I'm not sure if I have internet, but theoretically you would get to our wiki page. Another way to get to, so this would take you to our main wiki page, and another way to get to the wiki help pages would be by per operator by clicking on these little help buttons here. There's two of them. One is the general operator help, which explains what the operator does and explains each parameter in detail. Well, as far as we have filled it out. And the other one is the Python help. Python is the general scripting language in Touch Designer. It will become necessary to learn eventually, but Python, I find, is a fairly understandable, readable language. All the Python methods and members that are associated with an operator can be found via this Python help button here. Then there is another help which should be mentioned, and this is called op snippets. And op snippets are little examples for each operator. Now, when you open up op snippets, you would have to go into the help menu up on the top here and then find op snippets, operator snippets there in the middle. It's not as nice as you might know it from other software. Other software have more, those snippets are more tied into the software itself. We basically just made a big file with examples for each operator. So if you want to know how a movie file in top, how that could work, then you have here a little browser. I'll get to that browser. It will become more familiar in a second. And you can select the movie file in. And then there's various examples here for with an explanation at the bottom for various examples, basically how to control, in this case, the movie file in top, or the math top, or whatever. So this is a really good resource if you find a node, you don't know what it's doing. Not all nodes are in this help, but a lot of them are, and you can kind of figure out what they're doing via these examples. Then we have our forum. Oh yeah, it came up actually. So this is our wiki page. If you get the help for the movie file in top, it's just a little slow. It gets to the specific help page for that. There it is. So you have a little bit more of an explanation of what the operator does, and then per parameter, the help items. And the other thing would be our forum, which you can find under derivative.ca/forum. There's also a direct link on top of here at the top. The forum is pretty active. There's a lot of users, also professional users, that are giving constant advice, and the community is basically self-supporting. We pitch in obviously as well, but luckily we have a community that's very happy to help, that doesn't keep their knowledge to themselves. So you have, for example, people like Matthew Regan, which is who is one of the top technical leads at Obscura, who is spilling all his knowledge out into the forums, and also into the Facebook help group, which would be another important resource. Let's see when that comes up. Dum-da-dum. At some point. And that would be the help. Okay, so generally about the interface again. We have in the center here, we have what we call the network editor. So this is where your nodes live, this is where your parameters are, and this is where you create new nodes and connect them, deal with your whole infrastructure. We do have, inside the network editor, we have these various operators. They come in different colors. We have texture-based operators, which are called TOPS, texture operators. So they deal with pixels. We have chops, which are channel operators. This is all animation data or control data. So if you're getting, for example, if you're getting in data from Leap Motion or something, and like you can just connect a Leap here. And bring up, you don't have to follow me with this here at all, bring up the Leap Motion chop, then it's picking up my hand. So it's a fairly simple process to hook up devices and bring them in as control channels in this example here. Or you have audio, you can load audio files, or audio device in allows you to get access to your microphone. Things like this, and obviously a ton of operators to manipulate that data, to modulate that data so that it does what you need it to do. Other notes here, this is a component that deals with 3D renders. This being active in the default setup, so you can see it doesn't have a frame like the other nodes currently, and we'll get to that in a moment. But if you click in it, you can see that this is an interactive viewer. This is something that all operators and operator viewers in Touch have in common. All the viewers are interactive. So because this is dealing with 3D data here, you can toggle the cube with the left mouse button, with the middle mouse button, you can zoom with the right mouse button, you can pan around. Again, this is specific to the operators that deal with 3D data. And another thing that this default network, despite it not being so inspiring again, what it showcases though is that data in Touch can be translated from one into another form. So here, for example, I have an animation, a noise, animation channel generated from a noise. And this can be converted into a texture, into pixel values, by the very simple meaning that you take, if you look at a pixel, then a pixel has certain color values. Like you have a red, green, and blue, and an alpha channel for each pixel. So this idea here is that you take these values, and they're basically every value in this channel here represents the color value of a pixel. Since you only have one channel, it's going to be interpreted as a gray scale. But if you look, or let me just change a couple things here. So if you look at this closely, you can see that where there's a high value, you get white, where there's a low value, you get darker pixels. So this is a literal translation, and this works across all operator types. So you can convert 3D data, which is point positions, into animation channels. You can convert animation channels into 3D data. You can convert textures into animation channels. You can convert any of those into text-based tabular data. So it's going back and forth, and often this is required to do certain operations on your data. Touch Designer requires a lot of recipes. Kind of you're thinking, how can I solve for what I want to do? And then you see the nodes, you find the nodes that make that possible. And this is something that I'm basically, today I'll be teaching you certain techniques and workflows. Over time then you will come to an understanding how to figure out these techniques, like how to think in touch, basically, how to think in networks, eventually how to dream in networks, that happens. Okay. Well, I was mentioning the parameters. The parameters have, there's lots of parameters per node, and this is perhaps a difference to other node-based systems. If you have been working with MaxMSP before, or have been working with VVVV, or any other node-based system, then often nodes, single nodes have single functionality. So you would, if you want to add two things together, you would create a node that adds two things together. If you want to multiply, you create a node that multiplies. In Touch Designer, we group lots of functionality into nodes. That's why you see so many parameters partially on these nodes. So, for example, adding and multiplying and much more is all being done in a math job, which can combine channels in various ways, can combine different inputs in various ways. You can manipulate the data itself, you can rearrange the data. So lots of functionality in single nodes, which makes it sometimes difficult to find the right node for what you want to do. It takes a little bit of practice. We're working on a better system to make it able for you to find these nodes easier. So when you create a node, you just type in what you want to do, basically, and then it gives you the node that you're looking for. Currently, you type the name and you get, there's only a very linear connection between the node name. So basically we're working on it. Right, to create new operators, and I have brought up this this dialogue quite a bit already. It's the opcreate dialogue, which is a list of all the nodes that are available throughout all these different families here. And to bring up the opcreate dialogue, this is also one thing you will realize in Touch. There's always at least three ways to do something. You can hit the tab key, which brings up the opcreate dialogue. And then on the top you have your search. So if you're looking for math again, you just start typing and it highlights the node that you're looking for. Then the next row here is these different operator families, which is components, which deals with 3D in the rendering context. So you have lights, cameras, things like that. You have panel elements, which would be buttons, sliders, full containers to create UI inside Touch Designer, which might be an interesting thing to know, that Touch Designer basically, a lot of the UI is built with Touch Designer itself. So just to prove that point, if I go here to the palette, which I get to in a second, and hit the F10 key, you actually get to look at the network that built the palette. So here you see this element, which is just another network. Oh, actually, what is this? It's a select, so, right, it's here. So here you have the palette, and if you dive deeper, and I'll tell you in a moment how to dive deeper, you see that there's again, here's the 3D scope thing, the second part of the palette, and you can go deeper and deeper and deeper. So a lot of the parts of Touch Designer are built with Touch Designer itself. It's a good tool to create user interfaces as well. So that's comps. All right, then a couple. I will touch on the replicator and the window, but the other ones will probably not touch on other components that are very useful in Touch. Then we have the texture operators, which I was saying, but it's all pixel-based functionality, generators and filters. Then we have chops for all the channel operations, animation channels, and here you see also a lot of the device inputs. So here you find the leap motion input, you find MIDI, OSC, all the audio tools, DMX, etc. Then we have SOPs, which is surface operators, which is all of the 3D that's available in Touch Designer. Again, generators and filters. So with generators, you create 3D shapes, and with filters, you manipulate them. We'll be going through a couple of these. Matte are materials for rendering. And ducts is a little bit a special case. Those are data operators which deal with tabular data or scripts. So ducts is somewhere where you would do Python scripts, where you get in, you can also get in data from, for example, Twio for multi-touch events or TCP/IP data. And then you have callback scripts to work on each message that you receive. So this gives you the possibility to act on each message in a particular way. While in chops, when you get data via TCP/IP in chops, you have the whole channel, and then you work on this whole data package, basically. In DUTs, you can work on each single data point more precisely. I don't think we'll be doing much with stats and scripting. It's a different field in a way, so I'm not going to touch it too much. It might be worth mentioning that things like WebDAT is here as well, where you can pull data off websites and certain APIs and a WebSocket to communicate with websites directly. So that's the upgrade dialog. And we'll move on to the timeline here in the bottom. Now the timeline, I'm just gonna close the palette. I bring it up in a moment again, just to show you the whole width of the timeline here. The timeline is a little bit antiquated because it's not really clear if you need a timeline in Touch Designer. As Touch Designer is a real-time engine, it's software that should be always running. The timeline should be continuously running. And you don't necessarily need a range for most cases, because it doesn't matter which frame you're on. It's just, since it's always running anyway. Still, you have control over the range here. You can, it's a default timeline, basically. You can loop over sections of the timeline by setting it via the range bar here. You have on the left-hand side, you have the ability to set the frame range or the timeline range. Perhaps an important part is the frames per second, where you set your rendering speed, or not rendering speed, the frames per second that Touch Designer is gonna try to render. And then tempo, which would be the, if you're getting input from, if you want to have beat-based events, then the tempo becomes important. This can also be driven by MIDI, so you can connect it to external MIDI sources that give you the tempo there. One important thing is, what often happens is that suddenly you realize that nothing is happening and whatever you're trying to do is not working. It's usually because you accidentally press the space bar, because the space bar stops Touch Designer. Sorry?
It's like a toggle switch?
Yeah, it's a toggle. You see down here, it goes from play to pause. And this is really a common mistake, and it gets everybody, and it gets me still, because you're kind of like, what the hell, it's not moving. And until you look down here, it takes a while, but spacebar, very important. While the spacebar stops the timeline, and usually nothing happens, there's another power button here, because the timeline is, you can have multiple timelines in Touch Designer. So this stops the timeline, but it doesn't necessarily stop all the rendering engine. There's another button up here, which looks like a little, on-off switch. This actually stops Touch Designer completely. In cases where suddenly your frame rate drops down to nothing, you're running with a frame per second or something, and hitting space doesn't help recover, and the network is really not responsive, then hitting this power button can be very helpful, because it allows you again to navigate fluidly as it's not rendering. Beside it is a real-time. Well, here you see the frame rate, and my computer started not behaving very well when I'm recording, so I will not be hitting 60 frames today, but I think recording is more important than 60 frames today, so we'll deal with that. And beside it is a real-time flag. So if you turn off real-time rendering, it means that now Touch Designer will actually render every single frame. It will render if your frame rate is, or if your frames per second is set to 60, it will go through each frame and make sure that it gets rendered. While if you turn real time on, Touch Designer tries to hit 60 frames per second and it will skip frames. So it just says, forget about the last two frames. I'm trying to be in time. That's then the real-time flag. Why is this useful? If you're rendering out movies, for example, because you could use Touch Designer to render out your project into a movie, then you would want to turn real-time off, because you want to render actually each frame. But if it's a performance or if it's an installation, then usually it's much more it's necessary to have this real-time flag on. What I just closed here on the left-hand side is the palette. It takes up a little bit of space, and that's why I closed it down, and I would close it down again after showing you what it is. It's basically a collection of components that we feel are useful, or that might be, there's tools in here that can be, that might help you with what you're doing. For example, you will find things like a projector blend component in here, or we have a cam snapper in here, which is good for projection mapping. There is Kantan Mapper, which is another projection mapping tool. So you find tools as well as techniques. It's a small set of techniques. And you have image filters. So it's basically prepared components. And you can select one of these components. So I'm just going to go to tools and select. What will I select? Mm-hmm. Right. Let's, for example, take Stoner. And Stoner is a tool that's built to help you keystone images, for example. So it's a component. So the base is one of these elements here, one of these operators. And then, yeah, it basically does exactly what it's supposed to do. It's corner pinning images. And has added tools for grid warping, things like that. So it's useful tools, which are all built again with Touch Designer. So if I'm just going in here to show you, this is all built again with Touch Designer. It's a nice little network to discover. There's no magic in this. It's basically all just connecting nodes and a couple scripts to make this happen. And what I just showed you is navigating inside the network, which is a little bit of a funny thing. Up here you have an address bar, and the address bar looks much like in a file browser where you have /project1/. So yeah, very similar to a file browser or the internet. And now, while you cannot go inside these colored nodes here, like you cannot go inside tops, chops, sops, mats, or dats, these comps, these components, are actually containers that you can navigate into. So there are folders inside Touch where you can group functionality and basically organize your work. So this is the stoner. And if you use the middle mouse, if you have a middle mouse wheel, you can just move your mouse cursor over a container, and then it zooms you into that network. And now you see that the address bar above now has the address project1/stoner. And I can go deeper into the render, project1/stoner/render. And if I go the other way with my mouse wheel, I can navigate out again to project one. Another way to navigate would be the I and the U key for in. So you would have to select the node that you want to navigate into and press I. And again, you end up in project one stoner, or hit the U key to go up. And because there's at least three ways to do this, you can also double click on it to go inside. So navigating the network, and I hope everybody, does everybody have a three button mouse? Yeah, because the left mouse button lets you pan around the network. So you can move around here. And this is an endless canvas, so you can keep going. If you don't know where you are and you're totally lost, you can always hit H for home to center the network again. So the left mouse button to pan. Then you have the wheel to zoom and navigate. If you click on your third mouse or on your middle mouse button here, then you can just zoom the network. So without navigating inside a container, you can zoom in really close. And the right mouse button would be for selecting. So you can do these window selects. Now in cases when you don't have a three button mouse, now again, sorry, I'm not sure about the Apple shortcuts here. On Windows, it's Control Plus. The Mac equivalent would be Command.
Yeah.
So it would be Command plus Command minus to zoom. That's also a field that we're working on to with more and more people having touch screens or large trackpads, to make it easier to work just with that and not the necessity of having a extra mouse, but that's work in progress. So that's the navigation. And one thing I want to mention is preferences. This is always an interesting thing. You might see, let me just load a different image here. This is our banana, trusty banana. You will see a lot of references to bananas on the Facebook and Instagram posts and stuff. This image here, if you load up a banana image, or this banana image, especially because it's a TIFF that has an alpha, for you there would be a checkerboard in the background. I don't like the checkerboard, I made it black in the background. So this is a preference. So if you go to Edit, Preferences, and on Apple again I'm not sure if it's actually Edit, Preferences, or if it's under the
Touch Designer.
In the Touch Designer? Yeah. It would bring up this little preference dialog where you can set up certain things. So on the network, for example, I usually on the network tab, I usually have my snap to grid as fine, which allows me for a more precise positioning of the nodes. If I set this to coarse and apply, then it takes much larger steps for these nodes. So I always have that at fine. As well as my tops, the viewer background, I usually set to black. That's why my banana image has a black background. If I switch this to a checkerboard, which is the default, then it would look like this, which it, I just think I know if I have alpha. I like the black backgrounds. Okay, so the palette, I forgot to mention this. You can close the palette here with this X button. To bring it back up, there's this little weird icon here. It's the second icon in the second row from the top. This opens the palette and closes it as well. So I'll leave it closed because it gives us more space to work in our network here. Again, when you open up Touch Designer, by default, it presents you with this network with the little candy image there. Usually the first thing that I do, because I don't require that network, is hit Control A or Command A, which selects all nodes, and then hit Delete. And you have a nicely empty canvas here, which you can start building your project on. And I would like to start with building maybe our first little installation here, or it's not an installation, it's more an eyesore, but a pretty eyesore, I think. I'll just show you what we're building, and it hopefully will give you a little bit of an idea how to create things in Touch Designer, and then we'll go into detail what we've been doing. I realize you don't have to open up that file. I'll just show you what we will be building. I realize that I built all these files with an internal build, which is a little bit newer than the build we all have installed right now. So when you open up these files at home, most likely we'll see a little warning window which says, it's a newer build, but you can just click OK and that's fine. So here's my site adjuster, and it will become apparent why it's called site adjuster in a moment. I need a new computer. Okay. So my site adjuster is essentially, uh, my side adjuster is basically just a little animation that's controlled by the mouse. And yeah, you see that things are rotating a bit when I move my mouse in vertically, and things are changing in a different way when I move my mouse horizontally. So if you look at it long enough, you see lines everywhere, which is great. And we'll try to build that now. So to get started with this, you saw that we had like a circle kind of shape. And to create a circle in just textures, we don't require any 3D geometry for this. We would create a circle top. And to create a circle top, I just press the tab key to bring up the upgrade dialog. And then navigate to the top page. You can also switch between the families by hitting tab, which is an easy way to navigate. And then you can look for the circle. So if you type in circle, you should find it first column in the center. And when you click on it with a mouse, it sticks to your mouse cursor. And now you can place it anywhere in your network. So I'll just place it here. And it comes up with the parameters. And we can look a little bit at these parameters. What can we do with this circle? Well, we can change the radius. So if I type 0.1 in here, I can make it an oval. 0.4 again. I can do this with the second radius parameter as well. So you see you have control over the vertical and the horizontal radius here. This can be a little bit tedious if you have to type in these numbers. It's not very intuitive when you try to find a nice size. So what we did is we have this thing called a value ladder. And the value ladder is a concept where you, if you have a three-button mouse, you click the middle mouse button on this second parameter here. Let's try to adjust the vertical radius. And it brings up this funny value ladder here, which is basically amounts to increment this parameter with. So middle mouse click. Then you can select the amount you want to increment this radius by, like 0.1. And now if I go right, I increase the value by 0.1. And if I go left, I decrease by 0.1. So that's a nice interactive way of setting parameters. You don't have to type them in, you just dial them in. You can basically find the right size that you want much more easily. If you don't have a three-button mouse, you can also use the left mouse button, click in, and then you have to wait for about half a second or a second, and then the middle mouse, value ladder pops up, and you have the same controls again. Now, sometimes you want to control not just one parameter, but you want to control both parameters. And you can do this as well by middle mouse button clicking or clicking and waiting onto the radius here. So with the middle mouse button click, now I'm controlling both parameters at the same time. Sorry?
How do you control both?
If I click with the middle mouse button onto the name, onto radius, mm-hmm. then I get the value ladder, and then I can go left or right and change the size here. Um, other parameters here, they're pretty, I think they're pretty self-explanatory. You have a center where you can specify the center of the circle. You have fill color, border colors, background colors, including alphas. Border widths, if you have a border, then you can control the size of that border. You have arc angles, and this is a parameter that I'll be using. So here in the arc angles parameter, you can control the size of the gap, basically. And you can make the whole thing also a polygon, where you define how many edges, how many corners the the circle doesn't matter. It's the edges or corners of the circle. One thing to point out as well, which is important, when you place down the top, what resolution does it actually have? Because we're dealing with pixels, so this thing has a certain resolution. You can find that out by middle mouse clicking onto the node itself. And this is a pretty important little pop-up screen here. It tells you everything about the operator that you're inspecting. So, has names and types and some other information, as well as then comes the size, which is the size in pixels. So you see by default, the circle is 256 by 256. And it tells you about the aspect, formats, and a bunch of other information that can be very useful. I see that my resolution here is 256 by 256, and I want to change that resolution. I can do this in pretty much all tops by going in the parameters onto the common page. And the page is called common because it's common to all top operators. And right there, I have a resolution set to 256 by 256. Now I could change this to 1280 by 720, but instead of typing it in, I can also use this little triangle here as an indicator that there is a menu with predefined values from which I can select. So here easily I can switch the resolution to 1280 by 720. The other way to get this would be this little eye in the parameters. It shows the same screen. So with the node selected, you can click the eye. And since we have three ways of doing things, if you right click on that node, there's also an info. A little info entry which brings up the same screen. I haven't mentioned that. This is obviously also a thing. There's contextual menus in contextual right-click menus in Touch Designer. One of them, which we'll get to, is the network right-click menu. If you right-click into the network, with lots of layouting options and copy pasting, etc. And then per node, you have another right click menu, which then deals more specifically with the node itself. So we have the resolution for this circle. So now let's set the radius of this circle so that it fits completely into the texture here. And we can do this by, as I showed you before, middle mouse clicking onto the radius, or left click and hold, and then just decrease to something like 0.2. So the radius should be 0.2 in both parameters. And let's set the arc angles. The second parameter of the arc angles, I'll just type in minus 80 just to show that this one will have a gap. And now in my in what I showed you in this little animation thing, I had a second circle which was filling in this gap here, which had a different radius, and it was filling the gap slightly, or almost filling the gap. So to create that one, I can just copy and paste this circle here. So select the node. It's, if it's the only node in your network, then it's selected by default. And then copy paste it by Control C, Control V. And again, on the Mac, that's different, but you know what it is. And here, the first thing I would do is decrease the radius a little bit. So I'll make it maybe 0.14. And now if I change the arc angles to 0, it closes the circle. And if I put the same value here in the first arc angles, so minus 80, then it's exactly the gap filled with the smaller circle, basically. And now I have these two circles, and I somehow need to combine them. And combining, basically compositing them together. And there's various compositing operators in Touch that we have available. If I hit the Tab key, you can find things like the add and, I don't know, subtract, multiply, whatever. There's a lot of them there. And so I could hit Tab and select the add top. So make sure you're in the top family and then select add, which is the first one, and place it. And it comes up with an error. You have the little red X here. If you hit the middle mouse button or click the little I here in the parameters for the add, it will tell you why it's erroring. And the error here is because there's not enough sources specified. So the node doesn't have any input specified, therefore it's erroring. Meaning I have to connect it to something. And to connect these nodes, I can left mouse button click on the output of the first circle. And just when you click and let go, you have a little wire. And this wire, you can, if you go close to the inputs of the add, it already connects, like it's a little bit magnetic. And when you click again, you have your first input connected. And you can do the same thing with the second input. And now you have both inputs connected to the add. This is a little bit cumbersome, connecting these wires. There's more work involved than necessary. So I'm just going to delete it and show you a different way to do this, which is the regular way of, or probably the most used way of then adding operators, which would be you go into the output of the node that you want to connect an operator to, and you right-click onto it. So right-clicking onto it brings up the upgrade dialog as well. And now you can choose again the add top. And you see it comes already with the wire. So it gets connected. And now I just have to connect the one operator to it. A good question would be if I can do that all at once. Let's see. I'm not sure. Nope. Okay, so you still have to do this. So connecting nodes is fairly simple. Let me just disconnect that. You click on the output of one node, and then you go close to the input that you want to connect the two of the node that you want to connect to, and click again, and you have the connection made. Disconnecting nodes, the easiest, three ways. The easiest I find is moving with your mouse cursor over the wire and right-clicking. It gives you the opportunity to disconnect as the last menu entry here. Another way would be clicking on the output. And now you have a wire here. And if you click somewhere in the network, it disconnects it. I actually don't know what the third way would be. Delete, I guess. Anyway, three ways. Good. So that's good. I have my two circles, which is what I wanted to have anyway. Now the question would be, how do I control this? I want to control this gap with my mouse. So when moving my mouse in a horizontal fashion, then I want to control how wide this gap is and how big this pie piece of the circle is. So animation channels and control channels, devices, etc., all of these things come in via chops, as I showed you with the leap motion chop earlier on. So let's place before. So I'm just going to move this a little bit to the right here. So let's place here a mouse in chop. So you hit tab and go to the chop page and find the mouse in. Now don't use the mouse out, because the mouse out will start controlling your mouse. That might be unfortunate. So use the mouse in and place it down. And right away you can see you get a TX and a TY when you move your mouse. The parameters here of this of the mouse in chop will give you various options on how it should output this TX and TY. So TX here is, if I move all the way left, would be -1 and 1 on the other side. And TY is its aspect correct. So it takes the aspect of the screen and gives you the Y coordinates accordingly. So it's only 0.46 to 0.49, which is weird, but anyway. I think this is because the mouse in actually just goes across the, it stops working when you're outside the Touch Designer window. So it's basically from here to here. That's your active area. That's why the aspect in TY is a little bit strange. And because it is so strange, you can just change this output coordinates to absolute and you will get pixels. So 0 to 1279 and 30 to, something like 700 or something like that. Those are values that are nicer to deal with. And now I want to use this TX value here, which goes from 0 to 1280. And control this gap here, which is in a circle you have in degrees, 0 to 360 approximately. So, not approximately. So I would need to change this value here, which goes from 0 to 1280, to something that goes from, and especially looking at this value here, it's -80, to something that goes from 0 to -360. Okay, and we can do this. First of all, I need to select out the TX. I just want to deal with the TX itself. And I can do this with a chop that's called a select chop. A select chop lets you select single channels from a chop. So right click onto the output of the mouse in, and it brings up the upgrade dialog, and find the select chop. You will, by the way, realize that when you right click on the output of a node to bring up the upgrade, it will always go to the family that you can that is compatible with your operator, so chops. Actually navigating to these other operator pages here, you see that there's only a very small amount of operators suddenly available. Those are the operators that help you convert data. It also tells the story that basically in Touch, when you draw direct wires, they always have to be of the same family. So chop connects only to chop. SOP only to SOP with these direct wires. There's a different way, which I showed you earlier, which is conversion, but that's not with those direct wires, it's via referencing. Anyway, let's find the select chop. And the select chop parameters have a parameter called channel names, where you can either type in, there's a star currently, so it selects all the channels. You can select the channel that you want to select out via this little drop-down menu here in the back, or you can type in TX, and you have your TX channel available. The next step would be to convert this data from to the 0 to minus 360 value range, and I can do this with a mask chop. So right-click on the output of the select and find a mask. That's the fourth column, pretty much at the top. And the mask chop has all these operators that I kind of showed you in the beginning, which deal with combining. Then we have a multi-add. So theoretically here I could type in a little formula to multiply it by the right value to get to minus 360, or I can use this rearranging, remapping of a value. So this range page is super handy because it eases a little bit the math on you, like you don't have to do much thinking about this here. It takes a from range and converts it to a to range. So my from range would be 0 to 1280. In my case, if you're running at 1920 or any other resolution, it's basically the max amount of your resolution here. And it takes this range and rearranges it or remaps it to 0 to 1 by default. So you see here in the select 1, your value is 0 on the left side, 1280 on the right side, while the math has converted this to 0 to 1. And so now if I want to have it 0 to minus 360, I just change the 1 in the 2 range to minus 360. Okay, that's great. That's exactly what I need. And my next step would be I somehow have to take this value here and control this parameter. And this is done via various ways, but one of the ways that is most direct and I highly encourage it would be via something we call exporting. Exporting a channel value from a node onto a parameter. And to do this, I right click on the output of the mask 1 and bring up a null chop. Now the null chop is a chop that has almost no functionality. It's just a null. It's a placeholder. It can be very informative because it can indicate the end of a chain. And with that, the idea would be that by placing nulls to indicate end of chains, you then can take these values from this null and export them, and I'll show you in a second how it's done. But you still can make changes in front of it because the null doesn't do any operation. If you need to change the value, like you want to filter the values, for example, so that they're not so abrupt, then you can still insert a filter chop in before it. While if I would directly export from the math, then I could still put stuff in front, but if I would have to do things after the math, I couldn't, because that wouldn't be applied then to the parameter that I'm exporting to. Okay, that's a lot of talking without really coming to a point. Let's try the exporting first. So the idea would be to take this channel and place it onto this parameter. Now, how to do this? first, I would want to select the node that I want to control, the, that holds the parameter that I want to control. So here, the circle one, the archangels. And now I want to use this channel and somehow drop it onto here. And to do this, I have to click on this viewer active flag, which is this little flag here in the right bottom corner of every node. And what this does is it gets rid of the whole frame and gives me suddenly access to this interactive viewer that we were looking at previously with the geo component in the default network. So this viewer is now interactive. That means I can do stuff with it. I have, well, in this case, it doesn't really make too much sense, but I do have controls over like zooming in the channel here, for example. But the other thing is, if I roll over, it turns green, which means I can grab this channel actually. So when having the viewer active flag on, active, click on the channel and your mouse cursor should change to this little arrow. And now drag the channel onto this archangel parameter, the second one here. And then let go. And you get a little menu, and here choose export chop. And you connected this value to this parameter. And then you can turn the viewer active flag off again, so you get your frame back. So again, what I was talking about is if for any, and this is often the case, if I need to do things after after this, like I thought about something that I still have to do, and let's say audio filter is not really useful, you don't have to follow me here. I'm attaching a filter to the null. I'm exporting from the null. The filter comes after. So this filter doesn't have an effect on the circle here. So I have to place it before the null. I would have to place the filter before the null to have an effect. And this is where the null is really important, because if you have certain functions in here, if you would export from an operator that has a function, then possibly the functions that you still want to apply onto the value have to come after from where you theoretically would be exporting. So let's say I export from this math here. I'll find a better example for that actually. Null. The main thing that I mean to say here is always export from a null chop. Just as a rule for yourself, make it always export from the null. Do not export from any of these other chops. So I'm just going to repeat this. To remove an export, you can click on the circle top, go to the parameter that you're exporting to, right click on it, and then you have a remove export here in the drop down menu. And now I can practice the exporting again. I select the circle top, activate the viewer of the null one, grab the channel that I want to export, and drag it onto the parameter and say export chop. And I can do this with the second top here as well, with the second circle. I just have to export onto the first archangels. So activate the viewer, or if it's still active, grab the channel and export onto the first archangels. Now the effect of this can be nicely seen if I turn on the polygon for the second circle. Then you see actually that it's not just in the background and one above the other, it's actually both creating separate circle sections. Okay, and my TY channel, I just want to control a transform, I just want to rotate the whole thing. So to rotate the whole animation here, I can right click onto the output of the add top and find the transform top. And the transform top lets me rotate, has a parameter to rotate the whole thing. So the same thing that we did before, I want to select now the TY channel, remap it, and then export onto this rotate channel. So this brings me how to build a second branch, because we have one branch. If I would right click here and find another select, then it would insert the node into the branch. That's not what I want. I want actually a second branch. And to create the second branch, you can middle mouse click onto the output, which brings up the upgrade dialog as well. And here I choose a select. And type in the channel names TY. Right click on the output of the select job. Find a mask. And now I'm just gonna check my range that I have here. It goes from 30 to 700 approximately. So here in the, for me, so here in the range, I say from range 30 to 700. To range would be 0 to 360. And right click on the output of that mask, attach a null. And now let's export again. I select the transform top because it holds my rotate parameter that I want to export to. I activate the viewer, which is the little bottom right hand corner flag here for the null 2. And now I can drag the channel from the null 2 onto the rotate. And moving the mouse up down, it rotates the whole thing, while left right changes the arc. Yes.
So in the add top, there's also a rotate. What's the difference between putting that there versus the
channel? So the rotate in the composite tops, they have all the translate parameters, that's correct. And the rotate only applies to one of the inputs.
Oh, okay.
There is a parameter, and I'll get to that in a second, which is called fixed layer, which means which layer should not be affected by the transforms. Therefore, when you then change the rotate there, you see that only the first input is actually moving. Okay, and we can attach a null top to this as the end of our chain for now. And it's all the same process, right? Right click onto the output, find the null top, and we have an end, like a last element here. Now I had a little bit gimmicky things here. One of them was, for example, that I had an RGB delay. in this whole setup. Like you saw that it looked like there were some RGB things going on with this just white circle here. I grabbed that from the palette. So we'll build that later as well, but open up the palette if it's closed by going in the second row here, this weird icon, the second icon, and go to image filters. And a little bit down should be an RGB delay. And drag this RGB delay into your network. And this operator has an input and an output. So I can take the transform, the output from the transform, plug it in here. And now take the output from the RGBA delay and plug it into the null 3. And the RGB delay has a couple of custom parameters here where you can control how big the delay should be. So you can make it much smaller if you want. And that's the first effect I had added. And the second effect was that I was compositing this over kind of the black and white lines. And these black and white lines I created with a little generator component that's also in the palette. So if you go to generators in the palette and pick the checker component, that's the first one, and generators, and drag that in here. So this creates a checkerboard, and what I basically did was I changed the resolution of this checkerboard to be only 1 pixel wide and 720 pixels high. And now I composited the checker with the RGBA delay. Both have a top output, so by right mouse button clicking on the output of the checker component, let's pick a composite top. And the composite top is very similar to the add top. The difference is that it has pretty much all the Photoshop composite options that you would know or that Photoshop would have. Included in one operator, so you can pick from a wide range and test what looks best. So it has one input currently, and I can attach the RGBA delay to it as well by left mouse button clicking on the output of the RGBA delay and adding it to the input. And I'll connect the output from the comp to the null 3. And now you can select different ways of compositing those two together. For what I did, I chose the heat operation. And this is basically what I had built. Now, that's great. I have my final image, and I can display this image in the background of my network by turning on this display flag down here. Tops have a little blue display flag. And if you turn it on, and I did that for the last null that I placed, but you can do it for any other node, and I close the parameters by hitting P, then the viewer shows up in the background of your network. And you can have many viewers in the background. So you can look at your little network at various stages. Clicking those again gets rid of that. So I can display it in the background, but what if I want to have it as a full screen display now? And this can be done with a component, and this is a component called the window component. So let's hit tab and go to the comp page, the first page in the upgrade dialog. And in the third column under the other section, there's a window component. So select this and place it here. And I'll bring up the parameters with P and actually close my palette so I have more room. So the window component is what controls output onto your screen or onto a projector. And in our case, the first thing what it needs is an operator to display on your screen. So this is the null here. My null that I have would be that operator. That's good. Now a couple options, and the last section today would be dealing with the window component in more detail, but follow along just so you get an idea of what it's doing. I can set the opening size to fill my monitor. So on the window component, down in the middle, there's an opening size parameter, and set that to fill. And then I can already open it as a separate window. Let's try that. Open a separate window. And it opens up, but it has borders around it. So I don't want that. I want to turn off the borders parameter in the window component as well. And if I click again, open as a separate window, it now covers my whole screen. So you basically now have output on your screen. Yes? The window component is when you open up the Opcreate dialog in the comp section, in the third column, all the way at the bottom. Okay, so this would be literally a project from start to finish. You have control over the whole thing. You can output the whole thing. And it's a little, well, not sure if I want to call it generative, but you have a little animation going. That's controllable by external inputs. As I showed you before, I mean, here I have the mouse, but since I have the Leap connected, this could be connected to any external input device. So we'll take hand zero, palm. I'll just select out two channels. Zero, I think it's slash start. Yes. T X Y. The select also lets you rename channels right away. So I have here two channels selected. I can rename them from star to T X T Y. And I can replace it in here. Now these values, come on. This Leap keeps thinking it. Oh, there. My value ranges here are different, so I can probably set this to 0 to 1, and 0 to 1. And now, I'm controlling the whole thing basically with my hand. So the process is basically analogous. You can replace various input devices easily with the input device that you choose to use. Okay, so we have this. Let's save that as a project, because that's something I haven't told you. You can also save in Touch Designer. It's sometimes useful. I do forget that regularly, and there's no autosave. No. Because why? I think the autosave feature is something we didn't add because saving can take time. So if you forget to turn it off and during an installation it would start saving, it would start dropping frames there. So it's turned off by default. There's various ways now how to, you can just save it as a file basically, like save as, find a folder where you want to save it, and this is synth number one for me. The other way, you can also choose the first option here, which would be create project folder, which now lets you choose the folder where you want to put the project folder into, and then give the whole thing a project folder name, and create. And this basically packs it all into a folder. Now when you hit Control S after doing this, what you see is that Touch Designer actually saves versions. It doesn't throw away the previous file, it always increments the file, so you don't lose your old files. Now this can become a little bit could become a little bit obnoxious because it would fill up this folder with a lot of files, obviously. So in preferences, I'm not sure if it's enabled by default. In preferences on the general page, there's a option increment file name on save. You can turn this off, you can turn it on, and this option that I have here is on and copy to backup folder. So all my old versions, if I hit save here, my folder has the latest file that I saved and a linked file to that last file, and in backup is all the previous saved versions. So it's a little bit more sorted. I like it that way. I usually use it that way. All right. Well, that's good. Let's have a look a little bit more at, I'm just going to move that up here. And let's have a little bit more look at the various texture operators that are available. Now, just bringing up the upgrade dialog with tab. One thing I haven't mentioned yet, which is important though, is if you look at this, at these lists of operators, you see dark nodes and light nodes. And the difference is that dark nodes is what we would consider generators, so they generate data. In shape of, you have, for example, the circle, which creates actually the circle, or the, the leap motion, which brings up the video image from the leap, but it always gets stuck. I think that's my USB port. And on the other hand, what you have is the lighter nodes, which would be considered filters. So for example, when bringing in something like the video device in, which by default starts the camera, like a good citizen, I've got a sticker on it. There we go. So I've got the generator video device in, which is the camera. By default, you can select from tons of different cameras that you might want to bring into Touch. network cameras, etc. And you have, yeah, and you have various devices for the different libraries. And now a filter would be considered something that changes this data. So for example, an HSV adjust lets me change the hue or saturation of the image. So filter changes data, generator creates it. Okay, so what kind of generators do we actually have here? We have, most importantly, would be things like the circle, which we went over, constant, which is it just creates a constant color at a certain resolution that you specify via the comment page. There is DirectX in on Windows systems to bring in, not on all systems. There is the movie file in, which brings in images and videos. So by default, when you put down a movie file in, you get our banana. In the parameters, you can see that fairly simple. You have a file parameter, which when you click on the plus, brings up a file browser, where you can choose from a couple images that we have by default, as well as a couple movies. So let's just select a movie here. I'll just take. So it opens up in the samples map folder, which comes with Touch Designer. And I'll just open up this simple movie here. And it's now playing that movie by default. You have various options on how you want to play this movie. Sequential, meaning it's just starting to play and continues to play. Even if I move my timeline, it's always playing forward. There's another mode, which is locked to timeline. So now the timeline gives the frame to the movie file in, meaning when I scrub the timeline, I also scrub the movie. There's something you can see right away when I'm doing this, actually, that's worth mentioning. Not all codecs for movies are good to play backwards. You see, when I move the timeline backwards, then it's really it's choking. While if I move forward, it's fairly more fluid. And this is depending on the codec that you're using. So there's codecs like if it's animation codec or TIFF sequences or something like this, then they don't have to be decoded, or the decoding process is not as heavy. Well, if you're using H.264 or something like that, then it would have to decode the keyframes while going backwards, and this is more work, and therefore it's not gonna work as well when you're going backwards. So it's locked to timeline, and then you also have specify index, where you can actually tell it the frame, the actual frame number that you wanna play. This can be a very useful when you want to do scrubbing or things like that. I'll leave it on sequential. You have a play parameter, play on off, pretty self-explanatory. Speed. So speed, you can go super slow, or you can go normal speed. And this parameter might suggest that this is all you have available here, but a lot of the parameters in Touch Designer can be overdriven. So it's not that this parameter can just go from 0 to 1. If you use the value letter, for example, you can just overdrive it, or you can type it in, drive, or export to it. All these parameters you can export to from other sources. So that's the speed parameter. You have Q, so you can Q to a certain point and then start playing from there. If I pulse the Q parameter, then it's always going to jump to my Q point, so I can Q up movies. We do have a loop crossfade, which means that at the end of the movie, it can, if your movie is not fully looping, like perfectly looping, then you can use this loop crossfade to crossfade between a certain percentage of the beginning and the end. So you can seemingly loop it perfectly. Some audio options, and on the image page, this option is very interesting. Interpolate frames, which comes into play when playing this movie very, very slowly. So if I have this interpolate frames feature off, you see that it's jumping from one frame to another. Jump, jump, jump. If I turn interpolate frames on, then it's fading between the frames. So you can take normal speed footage and kind of play it smoothly by crossfading between the frames. The trim options on the trim page lets you trim sections out of the movie. And you have the extent conditions here, what to do at the end of the movie. If you want to cycle, hold the last frame, go to black, or go to zero. Difference between black and zero would be black has actually an alpha, while zero is nothing, literally nothing. The tune page I'm not gonna go over, but this is basically, this is interesting for when you're dealing with ultra high resolution content and you're dealing with preloading that content and how long the frame should wait before skipping to the next frame, so that your installation is running smoothly whilst trying to preload the super high resolution file. It will come up if you're dealing with these things. And this is probably also a good point to talk about some of the codecs that are supported by Touch. We have all the standard QuickTime formats and MP4, MPEGs, AVIs, whatever. And then there's Cineform and there's HAPQ formats. These HAPQ formats, if you have to display ultra high resolution or footage with that has alpha channels, then HAPQ really comes into is what we recommend for as a codec. It's very easy to decode, not very costly on performance to decode this. Another note that's a generator which is quite interesting or very useful is the text top. And maybe just place one down. The text top, all it does is it generates text. Very simple thing. So I can type my text in here and you have control over the font and font sizes, etc. Positioning, things like that, coloring on the color page. And all of these nodes, as we did before, we can combine with composite operations. And let's just try this. Let's add this text onto this movie file in and see what happens. So I right click onto the output of the movie file in and find the add top. And then I have my first input here and I take the text as my second input. And what happens is that suddenly my, not necessarily what I would expect by default happens. The texture from this movie is taken and squished into the aspect and the resolution of the text top. And that is where these fixed layer prefit overlay parameters of any composite node come into play. And they're really, really important to understand well. Let me just switch something here. Let's do this. Okay. So what these fixed layer and prefit overlay do? Fixed layer tells me which layer is not to be adjusted by any of these transform parameters here. So adjusting the rotate will rotate the first input because my fixed layer is input 2. The next one is that the prefit overlay determines how to take the non-fixed layer and how to deal with its resolution or the difference in resolution to my fixed layer. So here it says prefit overlay fill, which means take my non-fixed layer and just put it into this, into the resolution and aspect of my second input. I can change this to fit horizontal, so I get a letterbox kind of fit here, or fit vertical, which will fit vertically and cut off left and right. We have fit best again, which then tries to fit the image completely into it. And you also have fit outside, which fits it with the well, it's basically again taking the vertical resolution and fitting it in here. And then we have native resolution, which takes the native resolution of this and puts it in the background of the hello. And you can switch this around. I want the hello to be on top of this image here. And I can do this by just switching the fixed layer. So by changing the fixed layer to input 1, now I have a tiny hello here. And this is because my default resolution of this text top is 256 by 256. So now it's doing more what I might have expected. It's taking this image and plopping it on top of the first input. If I set this to fill, it will stretch this image onto this movie. And again, I have all the other options. Yeah, native resolution is probably the best one to choose here. And now I can position this. I can rotate my hello because my fixed layer is now input 1, is the movie file in. So I can do here whatever I want, scale it, etc. So these prefit overlay and fixed layer are quite important in that sense, how to deal with inputs that are different resolutions or different aspect ratios. Another very important operator that gets used quite a bit would be noise. So open up the upgrade dialog and find the noise top. And the noise just creates noise. It can be black and white noise, it can be colored noise. The noise is calculated on the GPU, so it comes for basically free. Well, kind of free, not free, but it doesn't bog down your process. And these noises are in various forms. You can have 2D noises, 3D noises. What's the difference? The difference becomes apparent on the transform page of these noises. While you can translate through a noise field that's 2D, you can translate horizontally and vertically. So these are noise values that are calculated while moving through the noise field, so it's not repeating or anything. A 3D noise also lets you translate through the Z, so through the third dimension of this noise field, giving you more of a non-directional, more organic change in the noise. You have control over these noise functions via their period and harmonic parameters. Noise in all forms. Noise is available in subs, tops, and chops. It's one of those you always use it. Noise is extremely useful for anything generative, for manipulating data. It always comes up. Very useful. And again, those parameters can be animated. So if you export to these parameters, then you have an animating noise that can be multiplied onto another image or in some way composited. And also good to know is the ramp top. The ramp top is a very simple top which just generates ramps. So ramps meaning horizontal or vertical, and in the parameters of the ramp you can set how this ramp should look like. So you can change the colors, you can insert keys. So you basically create your own little color ramps here, which are useful again as lookup curves or color lookups inside, or just when compositing images again. And this is actually what I probably should be doing. I mention as well here the radial noise. You have radial ramps which generate radial ramps and circular ones. And you have control with all of these. You have control over the phase and the period of these ramp functions, and you can select how they should be repeating outside their default range from 0 to 1. So this one is repeating, meaning after the white comes again the black, but you can also mirror it. And then, so the if I turn the period down, it's basically always zigzagging between those colors. Okay, I'm just going to use, just going to bring up a ramp, a standard ramp. And I want to show you one more compositing top. And for that, I'll create another movie file in. Okay. And here, what I want to do, I want to combine these two images via a mat operation. So a mat operation would be a composite operation where you take two images and you define which image to show via a third input, which is a ramp, for example, where the black pixels or the dark pixels would say, okay, here where they're dark, show the first input, and where the pixels are white, show the second input, in between, blend between the two inputs. So I can connect here to the movie file in 2 that I just created. I'll right click on the output and add a mat. And this has 3 inputs, as we can see. So the second input will be my little hello over the movie, and my third input will be my ramp. And now here it defines that my mat channel should be alpha. My ramp doesn't have alpha. My ramp is just, I think by default, has an alpha of 1. What I just did, I'll explain in a second. So I'll switch the mat channel from alpha to, for example, luminance. And now you can see what it does. Whereas the dark pixels, it picks the movie, the second input. The light pixels picks the banana, and in between it's blending. So by changing the period, for example here, I can basically control the blending between these two images based on my input image. Another useful compositing function. And last but not least, oh, I meant to tell you, I just did something that I meant to explain here. So I said before that all these viewers are interactive, and the interactivity for a top is when you activate the viewer with the little bottom right-hand corner flag here. Now you can zoom in, you can really zoom into your image and it inspect it pixel by pixel. You can also, H always brings it back into the normal view. You can also cycle through the different channels. So with the viewer active and the mouse over it, if you hit R, you see the red channel, G, the green channel, B, the blue channel, and A, you see the alpha. And if you hit A twice or R twice, it goes back to the full image. So the color channels were not really visible here because I don't have any color. So let me add color. And here we'll make some red. And here some green. Okay, so now I can switch through them. Red, green, blue, alpha. And if I add alpha to this, then I actually also can see my alpha channel. RGB alpha. All these options are available when you right click onto an active viewer, and you can choose which the display mode, and you can also enable this display pixel values, which lets you zoom in. Now you see the pixels as actual pixels and not interpolated, and you can read off all the color values. Another fun note that's worth mentioning is the texture 3D operator. What the texture 3D operator is, it takes in, it takes the images from the input and stacks them basically in a box. You have to imagine you have a record case, and you take every record in your record case as a single image in sequence. So I'll just take a video device in, the camera, and attach it to the texture 3D. And what you see here is basically, via the parameters of the texture 3D, I have a 32 image cache size, and it's filling up this texture 3D with my 32 caches. And what can I use this for? Well, for example, installations or a common effect would be this slit scan effect. Is that something that's familiar? It's let me show you slit scan photography. It is basically funhouse mirrors or similar things like as in video. So you can record video, and then when you move in the video, it kind of deforms everything like that. And this is possible using, for example, the texture 3D. And I need a ramp as my second input to something that's called a time machine. So when you right click on the texture 3D output, find the time machine top, and the second input to the time machine top should be an image of some, or a ramp of some kind. I mean, image works as well, grayscale, anything. And now the parameters of the time machine basically say that where it's black, it should take the pixels from the 60th oldest image in my stack. And where it's white, use the most recent image. So if I increase the cache size here for my texture 3D and move across the screen, you can see that it's basically displaying always a variety of different or images from different times in my recording here in my texture stack. And obviously, again, this can be you can also do this in radial fashion or circular, and play with that, or any other input like a noise. So a noise top would completely destroy the image, basically, just by picking various sections there. Now, this would be a good point to convert this into a little installation or something like this. You probably would want to get some external control for it. And let's say we want to use like a Arduino or similar thing. I'll just plug that in and show you the process for that. So I have a standard Arduino Duemilianova or something. Not sure how to say that right. And then I have my little breadboard here with just a putty, like a potentiometer. And I connect this here. Just need some light. Five volts. Ground. And this one, an analog pin here. Okay, so I have my Arduino set up. It's plugged in. And in the palette again, there's a nice little tool called Fermata. And Fermata is one of those, it's a protocol basically that you load up onto your Arduino. If you're if you open up your Arduino programming environment, then under the let's get there. Okay. Then under the examples, there is a whole section called Fermata, and you can basically upload the standard Fermata patch to your Arduino. And what this gives Arduino is basically Fermata acts as a protocol, as an input-output protocol. So you don't have to do any programming then on the Fermata on the Arduino itself, but rather you're using. You can use something like this Fermata component here that's in the palette under tools. Pick the port and activate the whole thing. And now you have control over the pins. You can set what these pins should do, if it should be an output pin. It's like via these drop downs you can choose. The analog pins, you can check if they're input, output, or whatever. And you can tell it to report the analog pins. And the first output of this component is these analog pin values here. Oops. So my putty is connected to the first pin. And you can see that I'm receiving the values by turning my putty here. I get the values back from the Arduino. And as with everything, I can use that to I can export this value, for example, onto the period of my noise. And now with now basically established control over this parameter via my Arduino board by controlling with the Arduino. So it's a fairly simple, that makes the Arduino really, or Fermata makes for me the Arduino really useful because I don't have to do any Arduino programming. I can just use it as an input-output device. And the output of the whole thing works fairly simple as well. I've got an LED here that I connect to one of the outputs. And that's the output 11, and I'll set that to be a pulse width modulation. And now I have control from Touch Designer over my LED here. Again, no programming on the Arduino necessary. And now I can use any of these values. For example, if I want to use the putty to also control the LED, then I can take this value that's already controlling my noise, but I can take it anyway and also export that onto this pin. And now I can now I control the noise as well as the LED on my breadboard with this. So that's a pretty simple way of getting getting sensors into touch that can be connected to the Arduino. One last thing here. I did show you previously, we worked on the, or we just dragged in the texture 3D, not texture 3D, the RGB delay from the palette. And the RGB delay is something that is very simply built also with just a couple of nodes. And it's a good experiment to do. Often what I find is that when you build these kind of things inside Touch, it also gives you a good understanding of how these effects work in other software. And I'm just going to use the video device in for this as well, because it's there. I hope you're not... that's fine. So the RGB delay is similar to the texture 3D. You need to cache a certain amount of images so that you then can delay each channel separately. The red channel of the image you want to delay by 5 frames or something like that, and the green channel by another amount, and so on. So we can use for that the cache top. So I'm just going to place a cache top here. And the cache top has also a cache size, how many images it's gonna store. And then to get to these images, I can either use the output index, and the output index is a funny parameter because it's one of the only ones that goes backwards, or where the default is at the maximum, basically. But the one that's more useful for this is actually something called the cache select. So by hitting tab, bringing up the upgrade dialog, I get the cache select top. And this cache select top doesn't have an input, but it has one of those reference fields where I can drag another operator on it. So I can take the cache top and drag it onto this cache top parameter. And now I can select the cache index for my red channel here, for example. And by copy and pasting this and changing the cache index to something else, I can get here my red, green, blue. And now I have to combine them again. And I have to combine them in a way that it only selects the red channel from the first cache select, green from the second, and blue from the third. And this can be done with an operator called the reorder top. So when you hit tab, find the reorder top, which is in the fourth column, pretty much at the top. And the reorder top has four inputs. So I connect the first cache select in the first input, second in the second, third in the third. And in the parameters, I can specify how these how they should be distributed. So my output red comes from the input one red channel. My output green should come from the second input and take the green channel from it, while my blue should come from the third channel. And you have an RGB delay. And I'll attach a null to this. So this would be now a fairly useful network because RGB delays are used quite a bit. So it would be nice if I could save this as a pre-made kind of, like I made my little effect and I want to save this now as a little component that I can always bring in again into other parts of the system. And there's a neat little function in Touch Designer where you can collapse networks. And what I want to collapse here, what I want to combine into a network, would be the cache selects, and the reorder. So select all these, and I select them by right mouse button clicking and dragging them along. And then right click somewhere in the network and find an entry called collapse selected. So it's in the bottom section of the whole thing. And what this does, it basically collapses it all into a component. So here I have a component with an input and an output. And if I go inside this component, and again, like navigating into it via the mouse wheel, either zooming in or double clicking onto it, or with the keyboard I to go in. And what this did is basically it placed them inside a new component, a base component, and added an in and an out node. So it has an input and an output now. And this component I can, it's easy enough to copy and paste this as one component. And I kind of hide a couple of nodes. I can structure my network better. But the other thing that this can also do is if you right click onto this component, you can save component TOX. So you can save this to your disk and call it RGB delay. And now in a totally different file or in a different project, I can always go to my folder where I saved it. And here's my TOX file. Difference, TOE is the whole project, TOX is a component. And now I can drag this TOX into my network. And I have this effect available. So you can basically save out components that you made and bring that into other projects, which is a fairly useful thing since you don't have to redo all the work. Any questions?
Like, do I have to go into the RGB delay TOX and edit it there? And will it go into the console projects?
No, it's particular then only to the project where you're editing it. There is an option where you can these components. All of the components have on the comment page a parameter called external TOX, where you can specify where this component is loaded from, and then on startup it would reload that component from disk, So when you make changes in that component, it would, on startup, it would be visible in all the other projects. This is a little bit dangerous though, because when you make changes in it, and you don't save out the component again, but save the project, then when reloading the project, the component will load again from disk, but as you didn't save the changes inside the component, that change will not be saved in the project, if that just made sense. So the external TOX is a little bit iffy, not, yeah.
Is there a possibility actually
of your right, so we don't have that currently in the upgrade dialog. We're working on unifying the palette with the upgrade dialog so that it becomes one thing. And so currently it's in the palette actually, where you can, there's a my component section in the palette, and here you can create your own folders. Let's say electric. And now you can drag those components that you want to save into these folders that you created under My Components. These are saved on disk as well. So if you right click onto these folders that you create yourself, you can browse them. And yeah, it creates those components basically there, and now it's available in all your projects. Yeah, there's a couple good things coming which will be interesting, because also we do have this thing, it's currently still commercial, which is the C++ operators, where you can program your own operators essentially for stops and shops. Those will potentially also show up in the upgrade dialog then. So they act as their own nodes. So palette components, totally custom operators, and the regular operators will all appear in the same UI as equals. It should be easier to find them and to use them then. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes?
Sorry, I missed how to create a component.
Oh, okay, yeah, so when you have them, can I actually revert that? No, I'll just do that in here. So if you select them, you have the couple nodes selected, and if you right click anywhere in the network but not on the node, so just anywhere in the network, and then down in the bottom, there's a collapse selected. And then it collapses it into one.
Good question.
Yep.
Then the effect that you just created, can you export it as a video?
Yeah, all of these, right, I meant to mention that. All of these things can be exported as a video. And to do that, let me take this one here. Oops. If I want to export a video of something that I made, then there's a file, export movie dialog here. And in this movie dialog, you specify the top that you want to export from. And then you can specify the frame range and resolution. And apparently you need a 1920 by 1080 monitor to see the start button. The other way to do this, so what the export movie dialog does, it actually turns off the real-time flag and then records the movie. There's another way to do this, which would be the movie file out top. Where is it? Movie file out. So here, I basically specify the file name, I can specify the codec in which I want to export this, and you can also specify an audio chop from which to get the audio for your movie, and then you just hit record. And when you're done recording, maybe I should make a change here. Okay, so I'm currently still recording. This is not doing anything because I changed my math in a weird way. 1280 in this, I don't know, 720 or so. Okay, so now it's doing something and it has been recording. And if I stop recording and now go to the folder, it created the movie here, which I can bring back into Touch Designer to play, or into any other program. I monkeyed a little bit around, so it... There's now my whole video that I recorded. Yeah. It's also a great way, by the way, if you need to convert between different codecs. It's pretty simple to do that in Touch Designer instead of using other software, especially when having to go to HAP or HAPQ, because it's near real time in Touch Designer, so you don't waste much time converting. Before we break, I think at 1 we should have maybe a break that would be useful for food reasons. I would like to go over things that I skipped over completely. There is, each node has a couple common elements, which is the viewer flag. Hitting the viewer will hide, you can hide basically what you're working on here by hitting the viewer flag. This can have performance impacts, especially when you're dealing with a lot of channels and samples, then rendering those in a chop can be quite heavy. And there this viewer comes in, this viewer flag comes in very handy. Also, Touch Designer will always cook only what is necessary. So if I'm, yeah, this is actually probably a good example here. Let me change this quickly. Constant, and I'll add a filter just to prove a point. This network up here, you can tell that it's cooking because why is it actually cooking? That's a good question. Is that node size? No. What? I'm cooking it. Okay, let's try that here. So, Touch Designer basically only cooks what is necessary for it to cook. So currently I'm looking at these three nodes here and I'm looking at the value changes that it does. I can tell that the whole thing is cooking by this wire that's animating. So it's recalculating every frame, it's recalculating the values on these three nodes. Despite not doing much, I mean, I have two nulls basically. Let's put a math here and change it a little bit. So that's actually, that touch actually has to do something. Okay. So you can tell the wire here is animating, which means it's cooking. If I turn all these viewers off, touch doesn't see a necessity for it to cook those nodes again because they're not being used. These values are not being used anywhere. And you can tell that they're not cooking because this wire is not animating anymore. This whole concept means you can build quite complex networks, and if you build them nicely, then touch will shut off sections of that network if they are not required. And this is a big thing about scaling projects. You can go huge because you don't always need everything. So touch is gonna stop using certain or stop calculating certain things, saving you time or making available more cycles to calculate the rest in your preferred frame rate. So this is one thing that the viewer flag can do for you. Also, when you're working in larger networks and you want to shut off certain branches, you don't need them right now, you don't want to have them calculated, turning off the viewer flag can do that for you. Now, if I have a select here, or let's say I export that value onto a color here, okay. So now this value is controlling this top. Turning off these viewers, since I'm still looking at this top here, touch has to recalculate these values. So turning off the viewers doesn't stop the cooking because I'm still looking at the result or the values being used in some way that's currently viewed. But when I turn this viewer off as well, it stops again. So it's trying to be fairly clever with these things. Other flags in here. We have an immune flag, which I'm not going to touch at all, but it's for cloning, when you're cloning networks. You can bypass nodes, which is this little bypass flag. So previously the node here multiplied the incoming value by 2, bypassing it. Now you see it's again between -1 and 1. And then there's the lock flag. Now the lock flag is a little bit funny. The lock flag actually freezes the node. It doesn't do anything anymore. It saves the data in its current state. And this is true for everything. This is true for tops as well. If you have a top that you need to be exactly as it is in another project, you can lock it, and when you save the file, it actually saves the texture of the top with the file. So when you open up, the file size is going to be much larger because it saves texture data in it, but you can basically move file or textures over to other people's computers or across projects this way. That's probably better to be shown with this. So put a little bit there. Control copy. I can delete this node, and if I paste it again, it holds the texture. So it holds the data when you lock it. Now when you unlock it, you lose it. There's no way of bringing it back. It's gone. But this way, if you send projects to somebody else, for example, and you cannot send all the movie files or something, but you need some kind of input or some representation of what you're working with, then you can lock the node and it will lock that frame. It will save the texture in the file. You don't have to send the movie file with it. Every node can be renamed. There's a name field here. I'm not very good at naming nodes. If you have a habit of naming things well, documenting well, then naming nodes can be really, really good to make networks better, give them better readability for other people. What we found useful is some kind of syntax that includes the operator name or the operator type. So it would be called math. But this here would be, for example, math mult 2, because this math is multiplying by 2. So you tell somebody without having to look at the parameters what this node's actually doing. So this can be a useful thing, renaming definitely. And the last common flag, the last two common flags, is the display flag for displaying the viewer in the background. this is common to all the nodes. Actually, I don't know if DATs have that. No, DATs don't have it. You cannot display DATs in the background. And the viewer active to activate the viewer and make it an interactive viewer. Any questions?
Delay, yeah. I don't know if I missed this step.
Yeah, so the main thing was that, or there's two things to it. The cache already comes with a certain cache size, so you didn't have to change any parameters in here. But then in the cache select, you would, if you have three cache selects for the red, green, and blue channel, each one, then you would say change the cache index for each channel individually. Mm-hmm. So I have -2, -7, and -8, for example. And then these go into the reorder top. And what the reorder does, it takes the input and assigns a certain color channel from the input to a certain color channel from the output. So you can say, input, the output red channel should come from the input one red channel. And the output green channel should come from the second input green channel.
The output is not a null, it's just an output.
Right, and here, in this case it's an out, but it could also be a null. It doesn't matter, basically. It's nice that you can zoom this interface, and it's nice that you can resize nodes. There lies a problem, though, with resizing too much. The problem is that when you, you want to look at this node in more detail, so it might be handy to resize it. But now if I add a new node to this one, it's going to be tiny, and then you start resizing this one as well, and eventually it becomes a little bit of a mess. So I try to prevent resizing nodes. There is, if you want to reset those node sizes to their normal size, you can select them and right click somewhere in the network to bring up the network right click menu, and then there is a reset node sizes. And this will just make them nice and small again, and then you zoom in and reorder, create a nice layout. There's also a layouting function, which I never use, because the way you lay out your nodes is a lot about how you think about the network. So it's actually really nice to go into other people's networks, because you kind of see their brains working. And therefore, the layout function cannot capture that thought process, obviously, and it will throw things around in a way that you don't want things to be throwing around. You can use it for smaller, like if you want to relay out these four nodes, then you can select them and right-click and say layout selected, and it will lay out those nicely for you. But let me just turn these viewers off here. But even this network here, if I now say Oh, let's see. This might still be good. Nah, it's okay. I wouldn't use it. Period. Yes. To randomize the seed would be a noise. So you would use a noise to randomize the noise, which is, we'll get to that right after, but there's a noise chop. And the noise chop can create random values. And there's a flag here on the comment page time slice where it then creates one value per frame. And now you could use this to export onto the seed of the noise. So that's possible. There is also, there's a nice trick that often is being used with the noise top and the random function of the noise top. So if you have generating random noise is usually fairly computational heavy, and but one thing you can do is you don't regenerate or change the seed here. What you do is you just apply a random offset to the texture, and because the noise is random anyway, nobody will know that. Let me just do that quickly. Dun, dun, dun. Random. Basically, nobody can tell the difference between between this, which is the noise just shifting and repeating, and random. Now I'm just going to type an expression here just to it's usually quite enough to just use the transform instead of recalculating a random noise to do random noises. But that's only particular to random noises. For the other ones, you would have to change the seed, obviously. Yeah. Okay, lunchtime. I think we can break for an hour or so. We'll continue at 2.
Can you raise your eyes?